with the recitation of the Holy Quran by Iman Abdul Rasul and Zara Panju.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أرأيت الذي يكذب بالدين فذلك الذي يدعو اليتيم ولا يحض على طعام المسكين فويل للمصلين الذين هم عن صلاتهم ساهون الذين هم يراءون ويمنعون الماعون صدق الله العلي العظيم.
The name of Allah, the most beneficent, the most merciful. Did you see him who denies a retribution? That is the one who drives away the orphan and does not urge the feeding of the needy. Woe to them who pray, those who are heedless of their prayers, those who show off but deny aid. Salat.
That was beautiful. Thanks, girls. Fostering and adoption is a very interesting topic that must be openly discussed within our community and the community at large. Unfortunately, it is not openly discussed often enough, which leaves unanswered questions in the minds of many as well as missed opportunities. Alhamdulillah, today we are very blessed to be joined by dedicated people who will share their wisdom and experiences firsthand. You will have the opportunity to listen, ask questions, and participate in the discussion. Our first speaker for today is Marzia Auntie. Marzia Auntie Hassan is a social worker and a relationship consultant working with individuals, couples, and families. After obtaining her master's in social work, she started Family Connections International, a psychotherapy practice based in Toronto and online. Marzia Auntie chairs the board of Jaffari Support Services, a faith-based social services agency that she helped found in 2008. Do you wonder why a person might want to foster or adopt? I would like to call up Marzia Auntie, who will provide her insight on this question.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الصلاة والسلام على محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي السلام عليكم everyone. السلام عليكم. I'm here on behalf of JSS to welcome all of you to the first ever seminar on fostering and adoption. And you're going to be hearing from, you know, very interesting speakers who will answer most of your questions around this topic. My role is basically just to welcome you and to give us a sense of what role we can all play. So we know that when kids are not safe at home, they are sometimes put into foster care temporarily, right? And if it's a longer term solution, then it can be longer fostering or it can be adoption. And we often, you know, in our communities, we are very wary of the Children's Aid Society, which is child protection. And hopefully today, when we hear from them, we will recognize that their job is basically to keep children safe and to help parents effectively. So hopefully when we hear from them, you know, it will dispel some of the misconceptions we have. And one of the things that we hear very often as social workers is that that Muslim children, when they are taken into care, when parents cannot manage at home, they often get put into non-Muslim homes. And, you know, from what I know about children's protection, they try their best to match children into culturally and faith-based appropriate homes. But the, you know, the reality of the matter is that we do not have enough Muslim families who are willing to foster children. And until that doesn't happen, their job is quite challenging. And again, that's when we, you know, have this idea that, you know, Muslim children are taken away and they are placed in non-Muslim homes. The idea is if there is enough support within the community, there is no reason why a single Muslim child should be placed with non-Muslims. So, you know, that's the first point. Now, obviously, you know, when we hear about fostering, we know that it is a fair commitment, You know, you need training and you need to have time, you need to have space, and you need a lot of things. So maybe all of us cannot be foster parents. And yet we all have a role in the well-being of our children. You know, we've all heard this thing that it takes a village to bring up a child. And we can all be a part of that village. And the idea of the village is that not everyone has the same job. Not everyone is a farmer, not everyone is a carpenter. But they support each other to do the job well. And when we have this, you know, because in modern times, we have this idea of minding your own business. And what minding your own business has done to our children is it's really not doing them any good. It's not doing families any good. So the message for today is that all of us can do two things. We can help families who are experiencing challenges. How? By not judging them, but recognizing that parenting in this day and age is a very challenging thing. And when parents are not able to cope, we can offer them a helping hand. And if yet they're not willing to, you know, so we can still do that and we can hold them accountable. So at the end of the day, the children's need for safety and well-being has to come above any other fear that we may have. And when we build a culture like that within our communities, then we can revive the village that it takes to raise our children. So we can support parents, we can encourage families to foster. And how do we do that? We can welcome those children who are being fostered or who are being adopted as full-fledged members of our community. And when we have that, when we include them in our, you know, because many parents who would like to foster, what stops them? It is often judgment from the community. It is the feeling of being excluded. It is the feeling that their children won't be, quote unquote, first class citizens within the community. So all of us can play that role of actually accepting these children, you know, with open arms. And obviously, you know, going a step further, we can encourage the many, many parenting initiatives that we have within our community. So at GSS, you may know that we have very often, we have parent drop-in groups, we have workshops and seminars, and the whole idea is to provide that support for families, to recognize that parenting is challenging, and you know, what happens when you're having trouble at home is that you try to exclude yourself because you're fear of judging. You feel shame because you think you're the only person. But all of us who are sitting here, we all know that we have, all of us have significant challenges at home. It may be, you know, amongst any kind of relationship, it may be with children, it may be with extended families. So when we recognize that, then we're able to offer that compassion to others. That if people are having, you know, challenges within their homes, what we can do, what our role is to support them rather than judge them. So inshallah, that is, you know, again, the idea that all of us have different roles to play. And for the well-being of a child, you need many people involved. It's not only the fostered family, it's teachers, it's parents, it's the community. And when we all play our roles well, then inshallah we can, you know, we can rebuild the village. So thank you and salaam alaikum.
Thank you very much, Marzia Aunty. That really puts things in perspective. Like the saying goes, when we stop judging others and ourselves, our hearts begin to open. Naturally, we all have a lot of questions on what Islam says about fostering and adoption, and who better to answer those questions than our very knowledgeable Maulana Rizvi. Maulana Rizvi is our spiritual leader and has been for the last 20 years. In that time, he has worked diligently to engage and teach the true principles of Islam to us and others. He regularly hosts visitors from colleges and high schools and answers all their questions. He is the author of several books and papers on various aspects of Islam, and we are grateful to him for his guidance, services, and for agreeing to be with us today. I'd like to now call up Maulana Rizvi to share a few words.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان العين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على محمد وآله الطاهرين I begin in the name of God, the kind and merciful, and with the Islamic greeting of Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in chapter number 5, verse 2 says, it's a longer verse, but at the end he says, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. Referring to the believing community, he says, cooperate with one another, help one another for righteousness and piety, and do not be partners of one another in the matters of sin and, you know, aggression towards one another. Keeping that, you know, verse in mind, we had to realize that Islam is not a religion which only talks about individuals. It's not a religion which only talks about spirituality. It is as much a spiritual religion as it is a social religion. It's very difficult for us to, you know, ignore when it comes to the matters of family life, you know, our role in the society, in our role in the community. Islam is a religion which talks about a community, not just individuals. And it basically says that, you know, believers are brethren of one another. In a sense, there is a relationship of faith where they have to be concerned for one another. You know, I'll just go to one story from the life of Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib, alayhi salatu wasalam. If you remember, and it's a story all of you almost heard it many times, that when Ali was the ruler of the time in Kufa, which was his capital, he was going through the bazaar, the marketplace, with some of his officials along with him, and he saw an old man was almost blind now, not totally blind, begging on the street. And he asked his officials that, you know, it's very beautiful the way he says. He says, Mahava. He doesn't say, who is this person? He says, what is this? The question was not about the person, about the situation. How can we have a almost blind person begging on the street in the capital of Ali's Khilafat? In a way, he was saying that this is not acceptable. So one of his officials, trying to, you know, justify, he says, well, هذا نصرانيٌ. He's a Christian, from a Christian minority. And Ali said, aren't you ashamed? When he was young, when he had the physical strength, he contributed to the well-being of the society by his talent in whatever he was doing. Now that he has become old and his eyesight has gone, he can no more contribute, you just left him without any support? You know, this is where he says to his revenue officers, include his name in the list of those who are to be supported by the government. And that is the matter of concern, you know, for one another in the society, especially when we talk about children. You know, in this part of the world, it doesn't work the way, you know, in Africa or South Asia or the Middle East. You know, here government has certain rules and regulations, and if they in any way come to find out that there is abuse or, you know, perceived abuse, it is their duty, especially when it comes to children aid society, to intervene for the safety of the children, even in their own, you know, home environment. And this is where we have to realize that, you know, as Muslims, we have responsibility towards one another. Not everybody is okay. Yes, we shouldn't be judging, but, you know, it's human nature, and I don't think even judging should stop us from helping them. You know, there would be parents who have difficulties. They are not all parents are really capable of fulfilling their duties. But this is where we have to realize we cannot just shun them, we cannot ignore them. If agencies like Children Aid Society comes in, and if the child is separated from the family, it is the obligation and duty of the Muslim community to do whatever they can to make sure that the child is then, you know, put in a foster Muslim family, At least, you know, there wouldn't be a clash of culture and faith and the values that they will be taught. And this is where, you know, in November, in one of the major gatherings that we had in memorial of Sakina, the daughter of Imam Hussein, I talked about this issue. And alhamdulillah, it had an impact that people started talking about it. And I especially brought in the name of JSS, Jaffari Support Services, without actually talking with them first, but the purpose was to just, make this conversation, it should start somewhere. And we are thankful to Almighty God that, you know, this process has moved, where there was initial contact between Jaffari Support Services and the Children Aid Society of York Region. And even in the initial meeting that I had, one of the meetings actually, it was good to hear their perspective. And as it was mentioned earlier, that it's not that, you know, Muslim children are immediately sent to non-Muslim foster homes. You know, the Children Aid Society tries its best. But this is what I'm saying, the ball is in our court. They can accommodate this whole issue of placing children who cannot be with their families in Muslim families, provided Muslims come forward, you know, and volunteer to be foster families. And this is where the ball is in our court. It is the responsibility of the community, you know, to do whatever it can. Yes, not everybody can do that. There are all different levels of fostering and how you can participate. You will hear more about it. And this is where I think we have to, you know, talk more about it and spread the word around, and that will be the right way of fulfilling our religious duty in this matter of supporting the children. I pray for the success of this initiative move, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help those who have this concern for the children and will fulfill their duties, inshallah, in the best manner. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Thank you, Maulana Rizvi, for sharing your insights. I think you have helped clarify some misunderstandings that often occur around this topic. It is a very common fact that organizations such as Children's Aid and others must exist in order to protect vulnerable children who sadly suffer in homes with the very people they would expect to receive love, trust, and security from. Children's Aid Society services Peel Region, Durham Region, York Region, and much more. Today, we are very lucky to have the team from York Region Children's Aid join us. York Region Children's Aid believe it is a community responsibility to keep children safe. They receive many phone calls each year from concerned citizens, teachers, police, healthcare professionals, and other agencies about children and families who may need help. When a family needs support, York Region Children's Aid Society links them with a variety of community services. Together, York Region Children's Aid Society and their partners work with children and families for a stronger, healthier community. I'd like to now call up Ms. Latika and Ms. Karen to say a few words.
Good afternoon. Thank you so much for having us here. This is kind of a first kind of for us in terms of coming out and speaking to your community, and we so appreciate the opportunity to be able to do that. I think there's going to be a slide presentation with a few slides that you may see. I think the first thing we need to kind of point out is, kind of as has been mentioned, we do have, the Children's Aid Society does have a legal mandate kind of within Ontario. And as it was mentioned, there are a number of Children's Aid Societies across the province, with every kind of community, every region having their own Children's Aid Society specific to, you know, helping and meeting the needs of the children and families. So there are currently about 40 48 Children's Aid Societies across the province of Ontario. So the York Region Children's Aid Society, we obviously are servicing the entire region of York, regardless of faith, with the exception of the Jewish community. If the child is of Jewish faith, there is the JFNCS, which we kind of bring in and kind of work together kind of with them. It is our hope today to kind of really be able to kind of share information with you about our mandate, as well as the ways in which we think that you can help us to work kind of with the children and the families kind of within your community. The first slide talks about our mandate, and our mandate is to, as it's been mentioned, certainly to kind of keep children safe, to kind of work with families to keep their children safe. And in that, when we receive information from the community, and I think it's been mentioned that sometimes it's the schools that call us, sometimes it's police, sometimes it's families themselves. And when they call us, it's our mandate to investigate any allegations that a child might be at risk of harm. And where necessary, it is our role to ensure protection. In most instances, we are working with families. Children are remaining in the homes with their families, and we work with them to ensure the safety of their children, helping them to kind of access any supports or services that they might need. We are endeavoring to provide guidance and counseling, and again, directing families to the appropriate services within their community. In a small number of situations, it is necessary for us to remove children from their parents' care, and it is in those situations that we are really hoping to appeal to your community to assist us. And it is one of our mandates as well to place children for adoption. And adoption is really that kind of final end point when the rights of the parents have been formally and legally severed, such that the child is now legally available for adoption and to be cared for by another family. So again, if there are families who are interested in coming forward and putting forward a plan to be the full-time legal permanent guardian for a child, then that's certainly kind of the adoption aspect, and we kind of oversee that. That the adoption piece is really far, you know, along the road in terms of the work that we do. So we're really probably going to focus on three areas of our presentation, and that's really how might we engage some of the families within the community to consider to be foster parents? How might we make you aware of your opportunity to be a kinship parent? And how might we also we encourage people to perhaps come forward and volunteer with the Children's Aid Society? And there's a process where you could be approved as a volunteer in the event that there is a child in your community who might require that. And it might be that that child is in our care living with another foster family, but you may be very helpful in connecting and volunteering. Maybe it's mentoring the foster family who doesn't know about kind of some of your cultural practices or your faith, and you may be able to kind of assist them in that regard. So that's really kind of what we're hoping to kind of provide you with some information today. We do have a system of service that's built on an anti-oppressive framework. We really want to focus, and when we work with families, we endeavor to kind of really look at what their strengths are, how we can build upon those strengths to assist them. In all instances, we are focused on family-based care, and that means wherever possible, we want to leave children in their family of origin. We think that that's the best place for children to be, unless there are some situations there where the children cannot be kept safe, and it's then that we want to kind of look at what is an alternate family that might be available, and is there a kinship, a foster family that is in the community? You know, we always are endeavoring to keep children within their own community wherever possible. We want to keep children in their same schools, within their same neighborhoods, those kinds of things. But unfortunately, because the availability of foster parents, there are times when we are having to move children not only out of their immediate neighborhood, but sometimes we have to place them outside of York Region because of a lack of availability of foster homes within York. This is a slide that speaks to kind of our focus, and it's a three-legged stool that we kind of really believe that in terms of keeping children stable and having children, you know, doing the best for children and families, we're really focused on three things. And those three things are really the well-being of the child, the safety of the child, and permanence for the child. And permanence as I kind of alluded to earlier, is really about wherever possible keeping a child at home with their family. That's permanence. But if the child does have to come out of their home and have to live somewhere else for a period of time, we really want to get that child back to permanent so that that child is not in limbo for very long. So really, we are always working with families to ensure that, you know, they have available to them every service, every resource that might be possible so that we can get that child home if possible. And if not, then we need to move on to an alternate permanent solution for the child. Again, safety, children are removed from the home when we are concerned about their safety. And again, we're always looking for services and supports to be put into the home to kind of maintain the child's well-being and safety. The next slide is a number of pillars of permanency, which is really, as I said, you know, and all we always are trying to prevent admission of children into our care. We want to keep children at home. But where and if necessary, there are kind of a number of steps that we will have to go through. The next slide is speaking about kinship. And I'm just going to speak about kinship, and then I'm going to turn the podium over to Latika, who will continue to provide some information about fostering and volunteering. Kinship services is an opportunity for the community, your community, when you know that there has been a child or children that have been removed from their home by the Children's Aid Society. And I know when we met kind of with some people from the JSS a few, you know, weeks ago, somebody said, well, how can we know? You know, will you let us know? Will you tell us? And unfortunately, because of confidentiality, we can't necessarily, you know, call you up and let you know, hey, a child from your community is in our care. What can you do? However, it is often that somebody within your community knows. And if you know and you think maybe my family could take that child, maybe we could put forward a plan as a kinship, because we may not be immediate kin in that we are an aunt or an uncle or a grandparent, but we have a relationship where we know kind of what's, you know, we might, you know, want to kind of contribute to what's best for this child. We are kin because we are part of that child's community. You can contact us. You can call us and you can say, me and my family, we would like to provide a home for that child for the short period of time, maybe a long period of time, for as long as it's necessary until the family is able to kind of do what they need to do to have the child return to their care. So that's called kinship service. It's a little bit less formal than foster care because the child is in your care. You become the legal guardian for the time period that the child kind of is in your care, but you're not a foster parent, so the child is not in the Children's Aid Society's care. The child is in your care. And there is a way to kind of do that. So if you're ever in a situation where you do think maybe we could put forward a plan, contact us, talk to us about that. We can kind of explore that. There is another opportunity for something that's called kinship care. Again, in those instances, the child is in the legal guardian, or we are the legal guardian, the Children's Aid Society, but we place the child in your care as a kin person. You still have to, as a kin parent, kinship care parent, you have to go through all the same steps that a foster parent would go through. The difference really is that you have a unique relationship, a special relationship with this child because the child is from your community, as opposed to foster care. With foster care, usually the foster parents are, you know, ultimate strangers to the child until such time that when the child is placed kind of in the care. So that's really kinship. So again, it's really, if you are aware, if you want to put forward a plan, please know that you can always contact us and speak directly about what that might look like for you. Okay, so that's kinship, and I'm going to turn it over to Latika.
Okay, thanks, Karen. The next slide. So, foster care is one of the many essential services that CAS is mandated to provide, and through the Child and Family Services Act. And it is protective services for children. When their family problems are serious enough for children to be removed for a brief period of out-of-home care. And why, there's many reasons why a child may need foster care. And sometimes children are coming from homes where they're experiencing physical, emotional, sexual abuse, neglect or abandonment, domestic violence. Sometimes a caregiver might be experiencing mental health issues. And CAS steps in to keep kids safe and secure until we can work out the problems with their family. So our foster parents, they represent the diverse community of York Region. They can they come from all backgrounds, race, religion, ethnicity, and some of our foster families are married, some are single, some are at home still raising their kids, some are empty nesters. Our foster parents are professionals, some are just working outside the home, homemakers, and they're from all walks of life. And how do we support? Once you become a foster parent with us, we support our foster families with many supports. They can, first of all, there's a training. Thanks. There's foster parents go through a 9-week course of training. And once they get involved, they can do ongoing training with us. And this is to prepare our foster parents with the skills and the tools necessary to do this role. Every foster family has a support worker to assist them to navigate their role. And once you become a foster parent, we do compensate our foster families with a daily non-taxable reimbursement to assist with the daily childcare responsibilities. If we can go into the next slide. Oh, I guess you don't have it. I wanted to talk about the number of foster families that we currently have. We have about 111, and we have about 448 kids in our system. And the largest group that we have in our system now are teenagers from the ages 13 to 21, actually. A third of our children and youth in care reside outside of York Region. So it's very important that we try to find families within the region so we can keep kids connected with their community. And we continue to support approximately 65 former Crown wards that are from 18 to 21 years to live independently. So I'm just going to go into one way you can help other than fostering. You can call the Children's Aid Society and become a volunteer. And I'll talk about the Big Buddy Mentor Program. This is where a person is matched with a client ages from 6 to 18 in the area, and mentors will take the client out in the community weekly. Therefore, they must have access to a vehicle. And a Big Buddy Mentor must be able to connect with a child at their level, be fun, have patience, be resourceful, and willing to work with children experiencing difficulties. There's other ways. You can become a tutor for a child, a volunteer driver. You can assist children in our homework club. And we have a family visit support program as well. The best thing to do is just to call our volunteer department and see what's available. And there is an orientation process. It takes about 6 to 8 weeks to get through the screening aspect and the orientation. With fostering, it takes about an average of four to 6 months to become approved, and that's through the training and assessment, and we do background checks and so forth. And I think that's, anything else we should talk about? Sure. So that's just wrapping up volunteer and foster care at this time. Did you want to add anything?
Thank you very much, Ms. Latika and Ms. Karen, for that informative presentation. I know many of you still have many questions, and we will be allocating more time for that at the end. So have you ever thought about what it would be like to have a new person in your home for a few hours, maybe weeks, even years? How about different people with different temperaments for different durations? This brings us to our very next speaker, Khalil Uncle. Khalil Uncle and Nisreen Auntie are an inspirational and dedicated couple who have been fostering children for years. Khalil Uncle and his wife, Nisreen Auntie, live in Brampton and have been foster parents with the Peel Region Children's Aid Society since 2004. In the last 13 years, they have fostered close to 30 infants, and they continue to do so. Khalil Uncle will address us on their journey and experiences as Muslim foster parents, and Nisreen Auntie is here as well with their 11-month-old current foster child.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in the name of Allah, the Most Beneficent, the Most Merciful. I would like to begin by thanking our resident scholar and spiritual guide, Maulana Rizvi, and the JSS, and the York Region CAS, and everyone who have come together to put this program together, as well as for having invited my wife and I here to share our experiences as foster parents. As you just heard, my wife and I have been foster parents with the Peel Region CAS since 2004. We foster infants 0 to 3 years. A lot of folks within our community who ask us about what we do are not very familiar with the concept of foster care. And I was going to start off by making this distinction between foster care and adoption and what we are more accustomed to as immigrants with orphanages and other systems in the countries that we migrate from. Having heard all this being clarified just before, I will actually skip all that and get right into our personal experiences as foster parents. Rightfully speaking, it is my wife who should actually have been presenting today. Because if you foster young ones, like infants, then who are not school going, one of you in the family needs to be at home all the time. And in our case, it is my wife who is the primary caregiver. Or as my 7-year-old son reminds me often, Mama is much better at foster childing than you are. So, but I'm here to share our experiences. How did my wife and I begin fostering? Back in 2004, my wife volunteered with a Muslim women charity and humanitarian group, the UMWC. And through that, we heard of a lot of incidents where Muslim children were removed from their homes for various reasons and placed into foster care or even adopted into non-Muslim homes. The CAS, as you heard, as a rule, makes every attempt to match a child's new home on the basis of religion, ethnicity, and so on. But this is not always the case, and often it is because there are no foster homes to match that child's background. We therefore felt we should step up and open our home to fostering so that in cases such as these, we could be a foster home to Muslim children until such time as when these children are reunited with their families. And so we called the local CAS, which was the region of Peel, and they invited us to an information session where many other individuals and families were also present. And it was at this meeting that we quickly realized how great the need was and that really we should make every effort to care for any child regardless of their background. And so one thing led to the other. We signed up for a home study. We went on a several weeks long training program. And as they say, the rest is history. I would, however, like to share some memories that we have collected over the years that many of you will undoubtedly encounter if you should consider foster care as well. Firstly, both my wife and I came from a fairly insulated family background where our faith and Eastern culture was the norm, and we hadn't struggled with many of the challenges that the children who need foster care today struggle with, such as the trauma that they experience at very young ages and at times even before birth. As an example, we quickly realized that unlike an unwanted or orphaned baby that you might adopt from a war-torn or impoverished country overseas, a lot of the children coming into care here were the result of neglect or the parents' misuse of drugs and alcohol or domestic violence. And oftentimes the children themselves had been exposed to the effects of their parents' substance abuse and even physical and sexual abuse. Many of them were not born out of a traditional marriage that we assume to be the norm, but the result of an unwanted teenage pregnancy. These were children that were mentally or physically scarred and damaged. You could say no one wanted them. And trying to restore them to what we might assume to be the normal state of mind and body for a child who has experienced trauma or extreme neglect is an uphill battle and a swim against the tide. Knowing this, however, did not put us off. It only increased our resolve to help the children. What is amazing, however, is that we went in all ready and determined to make a difference and to help. But surprisingly, over the years, we realized that it was actually we that were helped by these children. And it was these children coming to us and we to them as strangers that were making the difference in our lives. I cannot begin to relate and recount what each and every one of the 30 infants that we have fostered so far have taught us in realizing the meaning of true and unconditional love, of patience and empathy, or of care and relating to the challenges that others struggle with on a day-to-day basis. To this day, every time we see another one of our foster child begin to crawl or stand up on their own or walk or say their first word or giggle and coo or give us a really tight hug, we still feel the same sense of witnessing a miracle and feeling blessed. Is it easy? Certainly not. Fostering teenagers and preteens has its own challenges, but the little ones also come with big surprises. They're very adorable and cute when they've slept and fed and are all nice and clean and want to play. But try waking up every 2 hours to feed them when they're newborn, or staying up all night when they're unwell or cutting teeth, or simply crying relentlessly for a reason you don't know and that they cannot express. You go from being tired to being exhausted to asking yourself, tell me again, why am I doing this? To actually getting used to it and loving the smell of curdled milk and baby throw up. It all mixes in with the fresh scent of a newborn and the warmth you feel in your heart when you cradle them in your arms and they wrap their tiny hands around one of your fingers as if to say, I'm now in safe hands. I was asked to speak a little bit about the moments of sadness as well. As a foster parent, you encounter a lot of moments of sadness, but this is especially magnified when they first arrive and on the day they leave. Oftentimes, we've had newborn come to us straight from the hospital, and it breaks your heart when you see them walk into your home with a CAS worker, and all they possess is a little brown paper bag with a small bottle of milk, disposable, and perhaps one diaper. They have no clue why they've been separated from their birth family and whether they can trust you. My part, of course, is easy. My wife quickly assesses the needs and sends me out to grab the essentials. So from diapers to formula to diaper shirts and sleepers to bottles and bibs. And over the years, we have collected a lot of this and now have them in neatly marked boxes that say 0 to 3 months and 3 to 6 months and you know, boys' clothes and girls' clothes and little shoes and so on. But of course, some of this cannot be reused and cannot be stored ahead of time. Now, a question we often get asked is, how long is this child going to stay with you? And why did they come into care? And the answer to both of these is usually, I don't know. And this is true that we don't know how long they'll stay. In fact, the Children's Aid Society themselves don't know either. It could be days or weeks or months or years. And therein lies another challenge. The longer the child stays, the greater your attachment. And yet you could lose them within a day. You also have no idea of any issues they may have that may be genetic or hereditary. And of course, whatever we do know of their case and why they came into care is usually or almost always confidential and therefore something we cannot share. Fostering alters your social life radically as well. It has changed in our case from whom we hang out with, and oftentimes it means not being able to socialize or hang out with friends and family, and forces us at times to stay close to home. You may argue that even biological parents have the same issues with their own children, and even they encounter sleepless nights and babies throwing up. The difference, however, is that the children that are our biological own, they grow up. In our case, however, every time one of them leaves, it breaks our heart, but we press the reset button, and we repeat that over and over and over again. Try doing that 30 times, because some of this simply does not get any easier. I cannot fully express the sadness when it comes to saying goodbye. In our case, because we have infants, there is a deep sense of your heart sinking that you feel when you look into their innocent eyes, knowing this is the last time you'll ever see them again, or this is the last hug they'll give you as they leave your door and you part forever. What makes it more heart-wrenching is the fact that they are clueless, and they imagine they've only gone out for a visit and that they will be back in time for dinner and bedtime again. It gets to a point that even going away for a week and leaving them with a relief foster parent becomes difficult, because as you try and enjoy your vacation, you're constantly thinking about them. You may say again, well, all of us have to do that as biological parents as well. The difference, however, again, is that most parents or families will leave their children with a grandparent or a sibling or a family member that the child is familiar with. As well, our own biological children have hopefully never experienced the trauma and abandonment that foster children often have. In the case of foster parents, you leave the child with a stranger, and the child, a stranger to the child. And in their little minds and hearts, they have no idea how long you have gone for, if you will ever come back, or if they have been abandoned once again. It continues to traumatize them and erode their sense of trust for others and their ability to love others unconditionally. My memories are always around the first days the children come in and the last days when they leave. I remember the very first child we had in care. It was evening, my wife and I were alone, and the baby now needed a diaper change, and neither one of us had that experience beforehand. So it became a project in itself. How does this diaper go, this way or that way? What if it leaks? How many towels do we need? Should we call someone? Where do you place the baby, on the bed or on the carpet? And there was all these things that seem now in reflection, you know, humorous, but at that point a challenge. Of course, now we could change a diaper with one hand with our eyes closed, or while we are on the phone or multitasking. We once had a 5-year-old boy come into care, and when he came into our home, we introduced ourselves to him, and we said to him, you can call us, you know, Khalil and Nasreen. And within a short while, as he got ready for bed, and we read his bedtime story to him and tucked him into bed, he looked up at us and said, is it okay if I can call you Mom and Dad? And a week later, he was gone. We had another 4-year-old who stayed for 5 days, but all he spoke about was how much he missed home and how much he missed his mom and his granny and his sisters. I still remember one of our first child who stayed for a longer period was a Vietnamese girl. She stayed for about 4 months, and one evening we got a call to say she was leaving the next day. And unlike the norm where someone from the CIS would come home to collect her, I had to drop her off at the CIS office on my way to work. And so we packed all her belongings. She went to bed that night clueless that this was her last night in our home. Yet we knew that. The next day, I took her to the CIS office, and as we drove, she sat in the car seat behind. She giggled away and gurgled cluelessly, thinking we were going for a drive. I kept looking into the rear view mirror in disbelief that this was the last day that I was going to see her. When we got to the office, I was asked to wait at reception, and so I sat there with all her belongings. And there she was sitting on my lap. I kept hugging her and kissing her, but she had no idea why. Then someone came up and showed me her ID and said she was here to take the baby. She thanked me and took her away. And I stood there as they walked away to the elevators, and as the elevators door shut, Jade and I kept looking at each other, but only I knew what was happening. And so every time this happens, it kills a part of you. The most difficult experience, however, was yet to come. In 2007, we had a little girl who was with us almost from birth. She stayed with us for a year and a half. She was extremely attached to us, and she was extremely patient as well. And so I used to call her Sabira. We taught her how to walk, and we taught her how to say her first words. And many of our friends and families got to know her. We took lots of pictures and videos and shared many memories with her. Then mid-late 2008, the court ruled she was going to go up for adoption. We, of course, immediately applied to adopt her. The CIS, however, came back and said we couldn't do so. The reason? We were told we were not a cultural match. She was Caucasian, with an Irish Scottish background, blue eyes and blonde, and Catholic. And there was a family that was interested in adoption, and that family was Caucasian, Irish Scottish, blue eyes and blonde, and Catholic. So what are the chances of that? We were shocked at first, and of course, living in such a multicultural society as Canada, we could have gone to court, and we could have fought this tooth and nail. But we were told that this was better for her self-esteem when she grows up. And we had always promised ourselves to live by a fundamental principle and philosophy, which was, it's never about us. It's never about you. It's always about the child. You always do what is in the best interest of the child. Not what is good for you, not what is good for the CIS or anyone else. Things have changed now, however, over the years, and usually now the first port of call for adoption is now the foster parents. And so here I am 7 years later, still speaking to you about Sabira, but I still vividly remember the last night we spent with her and the morning when she woke up, the last breakfast she had at home, waffles and jam. We dressed her up, hugged her, kissed her, took pictures before her new adoptive family and the CIS arrived. And I still vividly remember when my wife and her stood by the house door with the CIS staff and adoptive parents at hand, and Sabira kept holding on to Nasreen for dear life and cried, refusing to go. I then took her into my arms for the last time and said, be a good girl, okay? And then I gave her away to her new adoptive parents, who drove away with her screaming in the car seat behind. With all these emotional experiences, you may now be asking yourself, do I really want to do this? Well, just when we thought it wouldn't get any better, in 2010, we were asked to foster a handsome 5-month-old boy of Afghan origin. When he turned 1.5, he went up for adoption as well. This time, we were approached and asked if we would like to adopt him, and of course we wanted to, and we did. People look at him and say to me, you know, he looks so much like you, I'd never guess he was adopted. He's now 7 and still dashingly handsome. I don't see how they see the semblance, but I'm flattered nonetheless. When we persisted in fostering after 2008, we of course had no clue that we would ever adopt one of our own. So when you find yourself asking, is the pain of loving and then losing a child worth it? I think the answer lies in first asking yourself why you choose to foster. Remember, with fostering, it's never about you, it's about the child. It must necessarily be selfless and not selfish. I'm here to say that whilst we mostly think of rescuing children of our own faith, consider helping any child, regardless of its faith or ethnic background. I'm also here to say to you today that if you should move forward with foster care, you will find this a very fulfilling and satisfying experience. And as you have heard, foster care is not simply for those who have no biological children of their own. A lot of families who have their own children foster, and a lot of families who are close to retirement as well. If you are nearing retirement and looking for something that will keep you active and give meaning to life, then as well consider fostering. It brings the best and the worst in all of us and those around us. In all the years that we have brought our foster children to the mosque and to other social events, I have seen both the warmth and receptivity, but I've also seen discrimination and racism, in particular when the child is of a different background that the ignorant among us consider as being inferior. As foster parents, we often attend events organized by our local FPA or Foster Parents Association, such as apple picking or visiting a pumpkin farm. We also have the opportunity to attend numerous courses, some very interesting and some mandatory, such as CPR. You can take courses even related or outside the age range of the children you foster, such as courses on drug abuse, teenage suicide, autism, and so on. In fact, just last week, my wife took a refresher course on car seat safety. This coming week, she's taking a course on introduction to ADHD, and I'm taking an evening course on developmental trauma, healing through brain regulation. These are just some of the many benefits you can gain personally for your own growth and maturity and to help us enrich our understanding of human psychology and behavior. I would like to end by saying that the Prophet Muhammad, peace be on him and his family, spoke greatly about patting an orphan on the head and the reward of every hair that combs through your fingers when you pat them on the head. I'd like to reflect on this for a moment. What does patting a child on the head or placing one's hand on an orphan's head signify? I think it means you are saying to that child, if your biological parent is no longer here, then I am here to shade you and protect you from harm and to fulfill your needs. It is to say that as long as I am around, it is impossible that you will not have someone to care for you or love you or feed you or be a guardian to you. It is not merely placing your hand on their head and then moving on with your life or forking out some cash to help the child. In other words, you empathize and share in their suffering. I want to say that this planet is a harsh place for our species to survive. We constantly seek comfort and pleasure and to deflect harm from ourselves, but we inevitably experience suffering. And in dealing with our suffering, I have found that we find more comfort in acting as God's representative and vicegerents by helping those who suffer more than us. That we find more comfort by helping those who suffer more than us rather than in others comforting us. Consider a mother who has lost a child. Does she find more comfort in others telling her they're sorry for her loss? Or does she find more peace in going out to help other mothers who have lost their children and telling them, I can relate to your loss and we can go through this together? Which brings me back to what I said originally. In our journey as foster parents, we found that the more we tried to give of our love and time to our foster children, the more we received back in multifold. And what they gave and continue to give us in love and happiness far exceeds what we can ever give them in fulfilling their physical needs for cloth or food or shelter. For we can never bring back their biological parents to them, and that primordial bond to one's own blood. Even though we fulfill their physical needs as best as possible, and emotional needs, their willingness to overlook and set aside their personal emotional wounds and trauma, and to allow us to replace their biological parents, and the fact that they accord us the same titles of mom and dad with unconditional love is unmatched and impossible to repay. Thank you, and may the Almighty bless us all. Ameen. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Khalil Uncle. This reminds me of a quote by Fred Rogers where he says, "We live in a world in which we need to share responsibility. It's easy to say, it's not my child, it's not my community, and it's not my problem. Then there are those who see the need to respond. I consider these people my heroes." We are privileged to have had the opportunity to hear from a variety of perspectives. Our final speaker for today is Sikandar Uncle. Sikandar Uncle was born in Canada and has been married for 15 years. He owns his barbershop in Scarborough and is a father to a son that he adopted 8 years ago through Toronto CAS. He currently resides in Durham, and him and his wife are pursuing a second adoption through DDCAS. I'd now like to call upon Sikandar Uncle to share a few words.
Assalamu alaikum. Never been called uncle before, but anyways, I just wanted to touch on my experience with adoption. My wife and I went through a terrible loss. She got sick when we tried to have our own child. And, you know, that's what made us decide to have an adoption. And I just wanted to touch a little bit on the process of adoption, because it is a lengthy process. When you decide that you want to do this, you go through a pride training. It's pretty extensive. It really makes you understand and ask yourself the questions if this is something that you would like to do. And for us, we were blessed. We were able to adopt a beautiful 9-month-old. And he's with us here today, Khalil. He's now 8 years old. He's hiding somewhere over there, playing some games. Oh, he's in the back there hiding. Khalil, say hi. And we're currently going through another adoption for our second child. And the reason why I'm here today is because 7 years ago when we adopted, we never had open discussions about this. And I just feel like this is such an amazing opportunity. My mom had come to me and showed me this flyer, because I'm not as involved in the community as I would like to be. But she thought it would be a great idea for me to share my experience for other people that are looking to adopt. It is a hard thing to go through, but the fulfillment that you get from raising a child of your own and having your own family, it's just amazing. And I know I just wanted to also say, like, people that are looking to foster, these things are like this service that you're doing for the community and showing other people that they should be foster parents as well, it would help, because if there are any other kids in our community that are having issues that need this help, it's such a good service to have. I know that everything that we went through was very hard, but the fulfillment of raising our own child and having an adoptive child of our own, it's no different than having your own child and raising your own child. And I just wanted to come forward and share a little bit of my experience, because if anyone has any questions or thinking about adopting and they want to come to me and ask me any questions or my family, we'd love to be in contact or of any help. Because I know for us, one of the things that helped us to understand and open the door for us was hearing other people's stories and what they went through with adoption. So I think it's great to hear that our community is coming together and having this initiative. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing your journey with us. It was truly uplifting. This brings us to the last part of our event, that is the question and answer session. You will now have the opportunity to direct a question to any one of our presenters from this afternoon. Please keep your questions short and to the point. Our volunteers will come around with the mic. Please simply raise your hand if you have a question.
Can I ask, are you ready? May I ask a question now? My question is, how long does it take to adopt a child, the adoption process, and what's the criteria?
The adoption process is such that the first thing that you have to do is connect with us to initiate a home study process. That home study process somewhat is dependent on the family who's interested in terms of, you know, there's a whole lot of paperwork, there's a whole lot of meetings and interviews that need to be kind of scheduled with one of our adoption workers as part of the home study process. So that might kind of, again, depending on your availability, depending on how quickly you're able to kind of complete some of that paperwork. So it could be over a 4-month period. You have perhaps a home study done. That's probably the shortest. You do have to complete a 9-week Pride pre-service training, which kind of, as this gentleman kind of indicated, and really that's an opportunity for you to kind of come for 9 weeks of training to learn about what it is you're getting into, what it is you're looking for, as well as an opportunity for the CAS to assess, are you a good candidate for adoption? And then there's the home study process. So it could be kind of 4 to 6 months before you actually have an approved home study. Once that home study is approved, then it really is about kind of the availability of a child that matches kind of what you're looking for. Sometimes I think there's some unrealistic expectations, perhaps that we have a whole lot of babies and a whole lot of young children that are just waiting to be adopted. Unfortunately, through the Children's Aid Society, that's not always the case. But there are a number of children who, if you are interested in adopting an older child, who might be available immediately. So it really kind of depends on a number of factors. Does that answer?
Just to touch on that, the whole process for us, it might be different now. We went through it 7 years ago, and once you've gone through the Pride training or the initial training part, you don't have to do that again if you're gonna be adopting again. So we didn't have to go through that process. But The first step is actually going through an orientation at your local CAS, I believe. And then after you've gone through that orientation, it'll open up a lot of questionings for yourself to answer. And then if you want to go forward with that, then yeah, you're going to have to go through that that pride training, which I feel was so informative. I believe that anyone adopting or being a foster parent or even being a parent in general is like so much information. And one thing is like all the supports that you have at your access, because these children do come with, just like all children, whether they're your biological or not, I mean, they do come with a set of like concerns, and navigating the system, and that's a lot of the tools they give you there are very helpful. So once you go through that process, and that's all about timing. It depends on when that training is available. And then again, you have to go through a home study, which depending on the availability of the resources at your local CAS, let's just say the whole process approximately takes about, at the very least, about a year. For us, about a year and a half. So it just depends on a lot of factors. So if that just clears it up. If you have any other questions, you can just ask me later on, or there's no cost whatsoever, you know? If you want to do private, that's definitely a cost, and there's a cost associated doing it private, but going through CAS itself, there's no cost associated with that at all.
When you say private, what would be a process of private adoption?
Like for us, we never went through the private process. I believe if you do private, you still have to go through some type of pride training, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, certainly in Ontario, regardless of whether you go through the Children's Aid Society, which is really considered a public adoption, or you could go through the private adoption, which is you could hire a private adoption or a private adoption practitioner to complete the home study, and you could attend the pride training through them. But it's called a safe home study, and that safe home study process is the same regardless of whether you go through the private or the public sector. The private sector is really you're adopting, perhaps you're doing an international adoption, perhaps you're doing an adoption where the child is not in the Children's Aid Society's care. It's kind of through some other arrangement that you have, kind of with another person around, kind of caring for their child, but the child is not kind of in the Children's Aid Society's care. And you can use, as I said, a private adoption practitioner, and you would pay for that service for them to complete the home study and for you to go through the training.
I have a question over here. What impact does fostering some of the younger children have on your 7-year-old son? Different people coming in and out of the house, the time that it takes to give them that attention.
Right. To be perfectly honest, when we first adopted our son, we also took a break from fostering for a little while. And this was one of the concerns, because he had, you know, we wanted to make sure that he is not, impacted by this, because as a child, if he were to see other young children coming in, staying for a few days, leaving for a few months, leaving, you know, he might interpret this to mean, I'm next, or when am I leaving? So we wanted to make sure he was settled. And then as now he's growing up, we went back to foster him, because now we actually wanted to expose him to that, because we thought that would be good. One, instead of being an only child, it will give him an opportunity to share and have others around him. And secondly, because just being aware of what we do as foster parents, so now he understands what we do and, you know, we're a foster family, it would hopefully help him as well with healing with his own, you know, past as he grows up. Other than that, it's been great, I think, and, you know, my wife is here with our 11-month-old foster baby as well. She could probably tell you more. So he's really acting as a big brother, looking out for him, and there's an age gap as well because, you know, he's 7 and growing, you know, older, and the children we're fostering are all still 0 to 3 years. So, you know, there isn't that sense of rivalry. So yeah, there are things to consider, but I, you know, at this point, I think it's working out very well, I'd say. Yeah.
You know, as adults, the attachment, we have our own coping mechanisms, but for him, do you notice that it's challenging when that child is removed from the home again, or?
I think we have, the child we have right now has been with us since birth, so he hasn't had that experience yet, and we do constantly talk to him and remind him of the fact that, you know, he's not here permanently and that he could leave at any time. And he does acknowledge it, but he does also say, you know, I don't want him to go and I don't want to lose him. So we'll have to see what happens, you know, when the foster child we have right now leaves. But I'm guessing there will be some, you know, preparation we'll have to do beforehand and after, yeah.
Can I just get Maulana to address the question?
I actually had to be in the banquet hall. There is a marriage ceremony going on. They'll just be calling me now, so. But before I left the office, I was told there's a question here that I, if I can answer this. This is about the Islamic perspective on adoption itself. When we talk about adoption in Islam, we realize that the whole concept behind, you know, taking a child who doesn't have biological, you know, parents or the support of them and to take care of the child as your own, there is no issue with that. The only problem we have in Islam is that you cannot give your own name to the child. If a child comes from a family, then the child is to be known by that family, the biological family's name. And I don't know whether, you know, CAS has any provision for that, maybe to have hyphen name, like for the ladies, sometimes they do the maiden and their marriage name, family names are combined. If that can be done, maybe that would resolve the problem, because Islam believes that, you know, you have to maintain that distinction between blood relationship and the relationship established through the process of adoption. But that doesn't prevent, you know, from people from, you know, doing whatever they can, as just like parents, to take care of the children who are in need of support. So that is the only technical point. Of course, it's also then the issue of mahramiyat comes in once the child becomes mature from the religious point of view. Then the issue of hijab comes in the family. And the only way of, you know, resolving that would be to get a child under 2 years old, and if the mother can somehow, you know, breastfeed that adopted child for at least 24 hours, then that relationship and mahramiyat is established between the adopted, you know, parents and the child in that way. So the way to go would be probably to get a child, either infant or less than, you know, 2 years, so that this process of mahramiyat can be established.
Uh, Okay, we have a question here for Sister Nosheen. Sister Nosheen, we have a question for you here from the ladies. What conversation did you have with your son about informing him he is adopted?
That's a great question. Hello? So what we did was, before we had that conversation, because he's eight, we wanted to make sure he was at an age where he could really comprehend and understand what adoption means. So part of what we did was to educate him on the word adoption. So we started, there's a lot of cartoons out there for some reason right now that talk about adoption and have the word adoption in it. So we started off with some cartoons, and when he would have questions about it, we'd explain what adoption means. We started bringing books home about adoptions. There's a lot of children books about adoptions, raising different families. So we started reading a lot of books to him. Once he understood what the word adoption meant, we felt when he got to the age of about five, I believe it was five when we had spoke to him, we sat down with him, we had a conversation about it, we talked about, you know, we bought the books that we were reading to him, remember what this meant, and remember there are some families and there's some mothers who are not well to take care of you, and, you know, this is what they do, and we had that discussion, but again, keeping in mind that he's still young and there's only so much he can understand at that age. So the conversation wasn't a lengthy conversation. It was really just letting him know that he was adopted by us. We are not his biological parents. And we explained, you know, how that kind of happened. And that was it. And if he had any questions, and at that time he had maybe one or two questions, like where the mother was and stuff like that, and we were able to answer that and keep it discreet and not too much information overload for him. And so that's basically how we kind of opened up the topic of adoption to him. And we feel like along the way, as he gets older, obviously he's gonna come to us with more questions, and you really have to be ready for that process. It's hard, it is challenging, because you have to have an answer as a parent. You don't wanna just kind of shrug your shoulder or not have an answer to give to him. So you have to make sure that, you know, when the time comes, that you're able to answer those questions.
My question is about the KIN program. I don't remember the exact word. What are the requirements, and is there a way that we can put our name in and somebody from the community, is the kid from a community needs, and they can contact us?
Yeah, so that's through our volunteer program. There's a program called the Big Buddy Program. So absolutely, if you were wanting to contact us, let us know that you're interested in becoming a volunteer, perhaps a Big Buddy, and you can talk about the fact that what you're hoping for is really to be able to specifically be a Big Buddy or a mentor to or for a child who might come into care from your specific community. And then you can kind of go through the approval process, and then it would be just a matter of waiting. And then, you know, you might go through the orientation program for the Big Buddy program, and you may think, okay, well, how about I be a Big Buddy for another child, you know, in the interim or while I wait? And that might be something you want to do, and it might be taking that child out to various events. It might be providing some tutoring, some just connections, just doing some fun kind of activities kind of with the child. But if you really want to just specifically work with a child from your community, you absolutely could wait to do that. Yeah, the volunteer process is you come to an orientation. There are some background checks and those kinds of things, but it's really probably, I don't know specifically kind of the time length of the orientation session. Is it 4 to 6 weeks for that process? But if you have your own children, usually it's you that we are approving to be the mentor, so that you would take the child, not necessarily home to your family, and it would be really about you spending time with that child, doing some one-to-one kind of activities with that child. It's not like fostering. It's really kind of one-to-one support. If you have your own children, can you foster? Yes, absolutely. You can foster if you have your own children. Yes. It really depends on how much space you have in your home, how many, you know, bedrooms, beds, those kinds of things that will help to determine how many children you could foster. But we have foster parents who have their own children, they have space, and they can foster up to a maximum of 4 children at any given time. We usually start out with 1, but you can foster up to 4 children. Yes, absolutely. Just give us a call and let us know, you know, that you're interested in, whether it's mentoring or a foster parent or a big buddy program, and we can kind of direct you in the right direction.
I have a question. After the adoption, is the child's file still open with the CAS or is closed?
So after a child is placed with you for adoption, the file, the child's file remains open for 6 months. There's usually a 6-month probationary period where the child remains with you. We keep the file open, and then as long as everything's going well at the end of the 6-month period, we close the file. There's a court process, right, in terms of you becoming the legal guardian of that child, and we close the file. You guys can maybe talk about that probationary period.
Yeah, it is 6 months, but during that time, after that time, probably during that time, you'll go to the court system and have it finalized, and it's kind of cool. You go to court, and the judge is there, and you get a red seal, and it's pretty cool. So we took some pictures of that. But if you did want to continue the adoption process, I think the file stays open up to 2 years. I'm not really sure, but that's if you're just going to continue adopting.
There was a question that was handed to me, and it was really just asking about the costs for adoption. And I think we answered that. There are no costs if you're adopting through the Children's Aid Society. If you're adopting a child over the age of, and I think it's 10, or a sibling group, you can actually apply and perhaps you could perhaps qualify or apply for what's called an adoption subsidy, and you can actually receive money through the government for caring. So it's children over the age of, I want to say 10, although I think recently I heard that age had been dropped to 8. So that really is because the children through the Children's Aid Society, we have a harder time placing children for adoption the older they become. So it was really as an incentive to families who were adopting children, older children, or sibling groups where there's 2 or more children. If you're adopting them together, then there are some subsidies, some financial assistance available.
Right?
I know you.
Okay, one question is, what's the age limit for adoption? I'm not adopting, but I'm 62. So what is the age limit till they can adopt?
I'm not sure there is an age limit to adopt a child. There's certainly no age limit necessarily to foster a child. I think, you know, we go through a process where, you know, you have to have a medical, you have to be in good health. It really depends on the age of the child. You know, if you're, 62 and wanting to adopt an infant, what they might be looking at is, you know, what will you be able to kind of raise that child through, you know, till they're 18 or 20, kind of when they're going to leave home, what kind of supports do you have available that will be assisting you, all those kinds of things. It's really, and I think as somebody mentioned, it's really about looking at what is in the best interest of the child. That's what they're going to be looking at when they're looking to kind of place a child for adoption. And adoption is really that permanent kind of home. But fostering, we certainly have some people who have fostered right up until their mid-70s. You know, recently a couple just retired and they were in their mid-70s and said, okay, I think we're gonna call it quits. But they had taken children up until then.
Another question is that, I don't know if you answered it. My daughter-in-law wants to know. Let her talk.
I was just wondering, in the process, do you consider, when you said that there's like a kind of a process where you're assessing the family, I guess, in that situation. Do you consider when you're matching a child with let's say adoptive parents and family, do you consider any kind of like background or cultural background or anything like that when you're matching, or is that not something that's considered, I guess, in that process?
Is it for fostering or adoption? For adoption. We do, absolutely, are looking at, you know, whether or not there is a cultural match. There's two pieces, right? One is the attachment we always have to look at, and that's where I think there was some discussion about a child who'd been in your care for a year and a half, not a cultural match. But I think as it was shared, you know, we did kind of say that we were prioritizing a cultural match at that point in time. But it really depends on a number of factors.
So at the York Region CAS, what would you say is the background of these children? Are they majority of them from abusive families? Are they orphaned? What would you say is the kind of breakdown, maybe percentage-wise, or how do they come into your care? Are they more from, you know, bad families, or maybe you could?
I'd probably just comment that there's no bad families. It's really kind of what I look at it is, oftentimes children come into our care when the supports that are available to a family outweigh the stressors that the family is experiencing. So, and it really depends on that. So I wouldn't say that children are necessarily abandoned. They are often coming into our care because they have been physically, sexually, or emotionally abused, been exposed to domestic violence that has impacted their safety, and we haven't been able to, or the family hasn't been able to kind of resolve those issues to ensure the child's safety. So they've kind of come into our care. There are sometimes probably more, if we talk about abandonment, it might more be the adolescents, the teenagers, that sometimes a family has said, I cannot manage the behaviors of my adolescent or my teen any longer, and therefore I am kind of placing this child in your care because I can't do it anymore. So that would probably be more teenagers, but I think the younger children, it's often because of their safety cannot be guaranteed kind of within the home, and therefore they come into our care.
So I had a question regarding, if you do qualify as a foster parent, can you request a particular gender, a particular age, or is it really based on needs?
Yeah, you can, every applicant that comes forward can certainly have a preference. And it's based on your makeup of your family, who's in your family, what's your confidence level and your skill set, and your home situation. We do require, if you are going to foster babies, that one caregiver be home full time. So, but other than that, you can, you know, base gender, age, and we work with you. And it might come where you have your home assessor who does the interviews with you. You might have an initial thought of an age range that you wanted initially, but by the end of the process, sometimes that changes based on suggestions of the home assessor of what's the best fit or what. We're always trying to bump up people to consider teens for sure. They want to start off, you know, with the school age kids, but after a while, you know, again, through discussion, through the pride training, you come to awareness about the whole idea of fostering, and so that can change.
If I can just add, I think there was a mention that kind of when foster parents kind of might go away on vacation for a week or need kind of a bit of break from fostering, there are relief foster parents available, and that is also something that you might want to consider. Maybe you're thinking, I don't want to start off as a full-time foster parent where I am responsible for the child 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, but you might say, maybe I could do it on a weekend, and I could kind of just start to get my feet wet kind of in fostering. And so that's something that also you could be thinking of, that maybe I'll just be a relief foster parent and take a child in for a few days at a time to give another foster family a bit of a break. So that's also an option. You also have to have all the training to be able to do that as well. Yes. We will leave behind a little bit of paperwork for sure. The training is after hours, generally, so it's 9 weeks of training. It's 3 hours an evening, so we generally run it 7 till 10 on a one weeknight a week for 9 weeks. Some children's aid societies run them on weekends, on Saturdays and stuff, but I know for us, we typically have always operated it during the week.
What a fantastic informative, oh, is there another question?
I have a question. Can you combine private adoption and public adoption? Can you do it side by side and then? Or do you have to choose either one?
As long as you have a home study completed, so you might have had that home study completed by us, or you might have had that home study completed by a private practitioner, that home study is what we call portable, in that you can take it kind of between the public and the private sector. So I don't know whether that answers your questions, but you can, if you can come to us with your approved home study from a private practitioner and say, do you have any children available to adopt? As long as you have that, we still do kind of a home study update process. So we still need to kind of meet with you, have you complete some additional paperwork to bring that home study kind of into our system. But I think you can go back. It's portable, your home study, once you have that. I think, I guess the only thing I'd say is we have to know who is applying to be the foster parents. So if it's you and your wife who are applying to be the foster parents, then we just look at your home situation. You might have grandparents or other people living in the home. We just have to understand kind of what their role is. We might say, depending on what level of care they're also going to be participating in, they may need to come to the training. They certainly would be needing to be on board with being in agreement with you operating a fostering home. So we'd probably have to have some conversations with you about that in terms of what your living situation is, what roles the other people in your home would be providing, in terms of what level of care they would be expected or what might be providing, to determine whether or not they would need any training. They would absolutely need police checks, background checks, all of that kind of stuff, because anyone in the home over the age of 18 kind of requires that. And then it just determines as to how much information we'd need for them from the home study. So we just need to have a better understanding. So I wouldn't rule it out. Call us and have that conversation with us, and we'll go from there. Okay.
Oh. Is adoption, if you want to do outside the Canada, what are the requirements?
Outside of Canada?
Yes.
That's not something the Children's Aid Society deals with, so that's where you would have to speak with a private adoption agency and a private adoption practitioner, because we only work within adoptions where children are what we call crown wards, which means that a child has come into our care, and during the time that they're in our care, we've tried to work with their family, but at the end of the day, we've gone to court, and a judge has severed the parental rights to the parent, so the parent no longer has any legal right to care for the child. That child is now a crown ward, and that child is now available for adoption, and those are the only adoptions that the Children's Aid Society oversees.
Yeah, I just had a question. Do you get Syrian refugees or any other refugees coming to the CIS at all?
It's a good question. In terms of, are we kind of involved with any families? You know what, off the top of my head, I don't know. I don't work currently kind of in the intake or the family services department. So in terms of who we're providing service to, I would say we are involved with families through, all walks of life, all income levels, all cultural backgrounds. So I would assume if there are families who, where their children are in need of protection for some reason, then we certainly may be. But specifically, I couldn't kind of tell you that.
I know there's been a couple of questions about length of time, and you've talked about pride training and the paperwork and so on and so forth. If you're looking to, for example, adopt a child, an infant, and I know you said there isn't a whole lot of infants, you know, that come to CAS. So if you're looking to adopt an infant, typically from start to finish, how long does that tend to take?
Again, a really hard question to answer. If a child comes into our care, so let's say the child comes into our care at birth, the mandate or the Child and Family Services Act basically says to us that we have a maximum of 1 year, or the family has a maximum of 1 year to do the work that they need to do to get that child back to them. So in many instances, children might come into our care at birth, and it could be not until they're a year of it old where we are in a position to kind of sever the parental right so that that child is available for adoption. But it really depends. It could be before that, because the parent may agree much earlier, or we may decide much earlier that while we could wait a year, there's not going to be a lot of change. So we could petition the court much earlier than a year. But I would say there are so many families that come forward to us to say they're interested in adopting an infant that it's going to be a long, if that's what you're hoping for, it's not necessarily something that's going to be a quick or easy kind of process, for sure, because there's so many people. They want a healthy baby, they want a healthy infant, and those aren't always available in any great degree. I don't know whether you want to add to that.
Well, we adopted him at 9 months, but we were told the second time around that we were quite lucky. And that typically that doesn't happen anymore as much. Like, it does still happen. Like, we know a few people and friends that have still adopted, like, a one-year-old or a two-year-old, but typically it's not a newborn. Like, that doesn't really happen that often. And I think a lot of women in general, the reason we always want a newborn is because we think about that bonding experience, and we want to make sure that that child hasn't been exposed to maybe a lot of different foster homes before they come to you. But you know, if you keep in mind, when you do get a child, usually when a child is that young of age, under two or so, usually they are in one foster home for that period. So, like, for example, our son, he was in one foster home and was looked after by a foster mother and a foster father, and then came straight to us. So he was only exposed to that one family at that age, and he has zero memory of that as of right now, right? And that bonding, yes, it's a little challenging at first, right? But you're also off for 8 months. You can take a full year if you want to. And so that is your opportunity to have that bonding experience with that child at that point. And when they're that young, that bonding typically happens quite quickly. At least that's what we found.
I think I just want to add kind of that probably when I see kind of infants kind of being kind of adopted in our system, there are a number of situations where the child is placed in a foster home, and kind of not unlike kind of the experience that the family kind of here has had, that child is with them for a year and a half, and especially if it's a cultural match, but even if it's just a significant attachment, we may say to you at the point in time that that child is available for adoption, are you interested in adopting that child? So as we wouldn't necessarily go out and look for another family who's sitting on our adoptive list, we would be approaching first and foremost the person who's been caring for that child for the past year and a half to see if they are interested in adopting. So if anybody's really serious about wanting to adopt, coming in via the fostering kind of route is sometimes one of the options that can increase your chances or the opportunities of having a young child kind of placed with you.
Sorry, can I ask one more question? For Khalil Uncle, I know you said you foster children between the ages of 0 to 3. What are your thoughts about adopting? Do you think you and your wife would have made the same decision if it had come to the decision of adopting a child that was older?
A lot of times these decisions very much depend on, you know, very specific cases and circumstances. if a child came into us as foster care and then stayed on for a long time and they grew up, now they're an older child, so you know there's already that attachment. And as we just heard, one of the challenges, the reason why older children don't get adopted as quickly, and the government even has incentives if you adopt siblings or older children, is because the longer a child stays out without having that permanency, the more issues they're likely to have that you would have to then deal with. So, you know, it would depend at that point in time how we're doing with our son. I mean, there's all sorts of, all kinds of factors you'd look at, you know. It's obviously easier when you have the child from a very young age. And I was actually going to comment earlier, but, you know, I think Karen just echoed exactly that to say, I'm hearing a lot of interest here about adopting newborns or having a child from birth. And outside this event as well, I hear a lot of people in the community talking about adopting a child from Iraq or Syria or Afghanistan or places where we may have migrated from and so on. With private adoption, it takes a long time and it is costly. I remember many years ago when we, you know, just looked at that at a very high level, we were seeing figures like $20,000 or so, you know, that was way back, I don't know now. But you can't simply fly out to another country, get a child, even legally adopt them in that country, and then fly back in with that child. With all the issues of, you know, child trafficking and so on, you have to go through an agency. Unless you went out and you lived in the other country for a while, adopted there, and then applied for, you know, legal certificates and papers with the Canadian embassy in that country and then come back, you know, that sort of a thing. So the best way really is to follow, you know, what we just heard, is if you start with foster care, because with adoption, if you specify your conditions to say, I want a child who's male or female, this ethnicity, newborn, very young, you're on that list, waiting list, there is a, the truth is it's very unlikely, you'll get exactly what you want. But with foster care, a lot of the children who have come to us have come straight from the hospital, newborns. And as we just heard from the sister, the child they adopted as well was in a foster home first and then came to them. So as a foster parent, if the child stays with you long enough and then goes up for adoption and you are asked if you want to adopt, you've already had the child from birth, you know. And we have not adopted directly. We have adopted through foster care. So I guess with your question, what are, you know, the chances we would adopt an older child? I think even if we did that, it would probably be through the foster care process if the child was with us long enough. And then there was, you know, we know the child's background, history, medical history. There's the attachment rather than going out straight to adopt. At least that's how we've approached it.
Up on that foster versus adoption, so or going through adoption through the fostering stream, what are the risks that essentially that after being a foster parent for a certain amount of time that you wouldn't be able to have that option to adopt the child if you are serious about adopting? I mean, like, what's that process? I'm not sure if this was already discussed.
But the risk is there, for sure. There are no guarantees. You know, the child might be placed with you, and at the point in time that the child is freed for adoption, it might be that one of their family members steps forward and says, now that the child is free, you know, I am the child's aunt or grandmother, and I want to adopt that child. And we may, the court certainly will, give heavy weighting to that family member adopting the child. The courts right now are heavily looking at openness as well, in terms of an openness means how open are you as the family who is adopting this child to maintain some kind of contact with the birth family. And that could be anything from just exchanging letters and a picture perhaps once a year, right through to actually having visits, allowing visits between the child and their birth family, even though the child is legally kind of in your care. So it really depends on kind of some of those kind of issues as well. But there's no, as I said, there's not going to be a guarantee that you're going to be the person that gets to adopt the child, even though the child has been in your care for an extended period of time. There's really a whole host of factors that we look at with, at the end of the day, it's always about what is in the best interest of the child. That's always our focus.
What a fantastic, informative afternoon we have had today. Please all remember to provide your details on the sign-in sheets that went around so we can update you of any future events that we may have. You can contact us or provide us with any feedback at the email address where you signed up, movingforwardjcc@gmail.com. We would sincerely like to thank all of our speakers and present them with a small token of appreciation. We wish you all the best in your journey, wherever it may take you. Please can I call up Muhammad Ali Uncle to recite the ziyarat, after which refreshments will be on the sides.
السلام عليك يا رسول الله السلام عليك يا أمير المؤمنين السلام عليك يا فاطمة الزهراء سيدتي نساء العالمين السلام عليك يا حسن المجتبى السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته السلام عليك يا غريب الغرباء السلام عليك يا سلطان يا علي بن موسى الرضا ورحمة الله وبركاته السلام عليك يا صاحب الزمان السلام عليك يا خليفة الرحمن السلام عليك يا شريك القرآن السلام عليك يا إمامنا وإمام الإنس والجن أجل الله فرجك السلام عليك يا شريك القرآن السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آله